Welcome here, everybody. I'm really pleased we're having this event. I'm more than pleased staying on stage with both of you tonight. And I welcome also the public out there at the internet tomorrow on YouTube, etc. So please spread the word once you get out of here on the Magna Carta or Magna Charta, which has its 800th university and anniversary, and it is a very special moment, but not only to celebrate. We just learned about the case of the eviction of the Runnymede eco-village, which was set up at that very place. Runnymede is like an old wood near Windsor, near London. And in 2012, people set up an eco-village, and precisely this eco-village is now threatened by eviction. So they try to build a legal case in order to defend their right, which relates back to the Magna Carta, and which went with it, the Carta of the Forest. So these are two, the Magna Carta is the kind of the one of the founding stars of our constitutional law, right? And 2 years later, in 1217, there was written the Carta of the Forest. And part of the Carta of the Forest is to make sure the access rights and the use rights of commoners to make use of wasteland, for instance, or woodlands to nurture themselves. So that is what these people are trying to do on that very place. And 800 years after, they are threatened by eviction and will bring their case to court. And there will be a hearing within 2 days. So please stay tuned and support the people from Ecovillage Runnymede. A second perhaps framing remark I'd like to do is you might remember that we are framing our legal tradition very much in terms of human rights. And there are, in fact, three generations of human rights, right? And mostly, we go back to the first generation, and sometimes kind of the very progressive people go to the second generation of human rights and the kind of the third one, the collective rights, the idea of reclaiming collective rights is very much forgotten. Kind of the same thing happened with Magna Carta, which has a long history, but the Carta of the Forest 2 years later went almost forgotten. So with this event, we want to kind of contribute to remembering that story and what was behind of the legal tradition we're living in today is not only based on the right of the individuals, but also on the idea of collective rights and the rights of commoners to use their lands. And the third and last remark I want to make before starting and introducing my fellow commoners here is that if we have a look at the Magna Carta tonight and innovative legal processes and projects and initiatives all over the world, then we do it as commoners, as people who look from a peer-to-peer perspective. Obviously, with a scholar background as well on legal issues, but basically trying to to strengthen that perspective from the commons to the legal frameworks we now have to deal with. So I'm very happy to invite David Bollier as one of the two speakers tonight, who will introduce us into the idea, the tradition of the Magna Carta, and link it to what is the commons discourse today. And Michelle Bowens, who will then give us a survey, an overview of which kind of legal innovations are happening all over the world. And how can we link this to the core idea enshrined, especially in the cut of the forest? And then I would love to invite you to have a common discussion. We'll have more or less 35 to 40 minutes to share your opinions, point of views, questions, and comments. So David is joining us tonight from Amherst, Massachusetts. He is an independent author, writer, blogger, activist, and scholar on the commons, and one of the co-founders of Common Strategies Group. Please, David.
Thank you. Well, it's a real pleasure to be here, where I've had many satisfying moments at the Bold Foundation, exploring and developing the commons through a number of conferences we had in 2010 and 2013 with my colleagues at the Common Strategies Group. So thank you, Silke, for that introduction, and thank you for the Heinrich Bold Foundation for hosting this event. I mean, I'm really kind of amazed that we're still celebrating something that's 800 years old. That's, you know, how many things are that old that we still remember and celebrate? But we often don't know the real history of this, which the anniversary is essentially about the signing of a peace treaty on the fields of Runnymede, England in 1215, which settled a very bloody battle, civil war, between the much despised King John and his rebellious barons and commoners of 8 centuries ago. And what was intended as an armistice, a peace treaty, was soon regarded as a canonical statement about the proper structure of governance. And amidst a lot of archaic language about medieval ways of life, Magna Carta is now seen as this landmark statement about the limited powers of the sovereign and the rights and liberties of ordinary people. The king's acceptance of the Magna Carta after a long civil war is really unbelievably distant and almost forgotten. How could it have anything to do with us today, with us moderns? And that's what I really find amazing. And I think its durability and resonance have to do with our wariness, our skepticism about concentrated power, especially of the sovereign. We like to remind ourselves that the authority is restrained by the rule of law, and that this represents a new and civilizing moment in human history. And we love to identify with the underdog and declare that even kings must respect something transcendent and universal called law, which is said to protect individual rights and liberties. And it was in this spirit that the American Bar Association erected that image, that monument we saw on the screen a moment ago, in 1957, and it bore the inscription, "Freedom Under Law." And on grand public occasions, especially this year, we see judges and politicians and law scholars and distinguished gray eminences get up and declare how constitutional government and representative democracy are continuing to uphold the principles of Magna Carta. And I'll have more to say about that in a moment. But this evening, I'd like to explore a richer, more complex story about Magna Carta and its meanings for us today. Because in fact, there are two distinct but related stories to be told. Story number one, we might call the triumph of the market state. And that's the story I basically just told, which is usually invoked by the distinguished elites of our society to celebrate constitutional democracy and its close alliance with so-called free markets and the idea of freedom under law, all of which are, of course, significant achievements in many respects, but I also want to tell story number two. Story number one assures us that constitutional government and representative democracy actually serve as the brave bulwarks of liberty and law of Magna Carta. And to be sure, this is a great advance over monarchy, tribalism, and the Hobbesian war of each against all that prevailed in many regions of the world then and afterwards. But I'm interested in a story that doesn't get told very often. I call it story number two, or Law for the Commons. And it doesn't have the high-minded flourishes or the sanctimony that is often associated with the official mainstream story. It's a more down-to-earth and story that's focused more on ordinary people, the commoners. And this second story is less about the signing of the Magna Carta than about the ongoing struggle, the unfinished struggle, to make those principles real in everybody, in people's lives. And so it's about the story number two is about the functional legal significance of Magna Carta in meeting people's everyday survival needs and in fulfilling human rights. It's about assuring that everyone can access the commonwealth that we all inherit together. Or put more plainly, you might say story number two is about who may use the king's forests. Now, the answer to that among commoners in the early 1200s was, what do you mean the king's forests? They belong to us, or they've been ours for centuries. And of course, they were reacting to the king's enclosures of and taking over of many of those forests that had traditionally been theirs. So the forgotten legacy of the Magna Carta is really the frank acknowledgement that commoners have rights too. The right of the commoners to use the forest, the right to self-organize their own rules for accessing and protecting those resources, and the civil rights and liberties to protect themselves from the sovereign's arbitrary abuses of power. Now, all of these preceded the very idea of written law and Magna Carta. They were considered human rights based on fundamental needs and long-standing traditions. And we have to remember that in the 13th century, commoners relied upon the forest for nearly everything. They used the forest to cook their to find food to cook, and to heat their houses. They caught wild game and fish from the forests. They used acorns and plants for their pigs, which was quite important. And so, in a sense, the forest was an entire universe. A place that may have been owned by feudal lords, but nonetheless a place that commoners were entitled by long-standing custom to use for their everyday needs. And so it was a place that really inframed their culture, their imaginations, and their very identity. So when King John started arrogating to himself greater and greater control of forest lands, it produced a serious squeeze, not just on the feudal nobility, who, of course, objected and fought back, but also on the commoners whose daily survival was now jeopardized. The royal encroachments of the forest, which were ruthlessly enforced by the king's sheriffs, meant that livestock couldn't roam the forest anymore. Pigs couldn't eat acorns and grow fat. Commoners could not gather timber to fix their homes. Fruit and fish could not be taken and eaten. Boats couldn't navigate on rivers upon which dams or private causeways had been built. So all of this, and much else, of course, prolonged the bitter civil war in England before it was ultimately resolved through the Magna Carta. It was a political struggle. And the terms of peace were a series of legal limitations in writing on the king's absolute power and a series of stipulated legal rights for people, including commoners. Now, what's usually forgotten in this story of the Magna Carta is the companion document that was officially incorporated 2 years later, called the Charter of the Forest. And this document explicitly protected the customary rights of commoners. It's really kind of a human rights convention that guaranteed commoners the specific rights, such as the rights of panage, which was the right for pasture for their pigs, or the right of estover, which is the right to collect firewood, or the right of agistement, which is to graze cattle, or the right of turbary, which is to cut turf for fuel, and so on. All of these, of course, rooted in medieval everyday life. But it was, in a sense, a story that isn't really told these days, but the Charter of the Forest was the first legal limitation on privatization of the commons. Now, that's a story we really don't hear in these official recognitions, celebrations of the Magna Carta, but it's really one of the great achievements of Magna Carta because it granted commoners a formal right of access to the collective resources fundamental to human survival. And so it protected them against acts of what we would now call acts of state terror by prohibiting the king's sheriff from abusive arrests and mayhem and torture in the course of defending the king's arbitrary enclosures. Now, unfortunately, Magna Carta did not come equipped with the means to self-enforce its principles. The sovereign could suspend the transcendent law at will, restrained only by the social or political outcry that might result. And this is exactly what has happened in the centuries since Magna Carta was signed. In 1536, King Henry VIII eliminated Catholic monasteries in England, which was, as Peter Linebaugh, the historian, calls it, a massive act of state-sponsored privatization. He writes, quote, "This opened the door for a new class, the gentry, to take the land and turn it to profit by means of enclosures." So the dissolution of monasteries was a massive act of state-sponsored privatization that converted the English landmass into a commodity. It was like the disenchantment of the land, according to one journalist at the time. And then in the 17th and 18th centuries, Parliament authorized some 4,000 acts of enclosure on behalf of the ruling or the rising class of gentry. And this allowed them to appropriate about 15% of all land, common lands in England for their private use. Now, these enclosures destroyed many commoners' deep connections to the soil and really destroyed their cultures and traditions, paving the way for industrialization. And so, in the process, a new class of people were created, proletariats, consumers, paupers. People who had once been commoners were dispossessed of their commons, and they had no choice but to try to find a place for themselves in the new capitalist order. So what became of the Magna Carta in this new world? The supremacy of the written law was supposed to be a great advance in giving law greater durability and respect. But I think we overrate the power of written law. Yes, the law was written and formal, and it helped make rules of governance seem more permanent and even timeless. And certainly the champions of the Magna Carta, including the king, have tried to promote this idea about law. Yet, in truth, when law becomes disconnected from the social community that's governed by it, when active consent can be overridden by interpretations by professional lawyers or politicians or judges, it's really the first step to a new kind of tyranny, because written law opens the door to this problem because legality and legitimacy get separated. They're not the same, but they get separated. And so by making law an artifact of the printed word, something that professional lawyers and jurists and outsiders could present as objective and universal set of rules, written law in a strange way began to create a new realm of governance called legality. And it became an object of external interpretation and manipulation and even corruption, something that was divorced from the people themselves and their social practices. Law became an icon to be invoked as absolute and independent, requiring strict obedience. Yet, at the very same time, law as a written code became something that the king started to see the virtues of, because he could claim the mantle of legality so long as it had some plausible relationship to formal written documents. And who cares about legitimacy? That no longer was as important. It didn't have to be earned necessarily, at least under the monarchy. And even one could say today, the legitimacy that today's sovereigns have is not as earned as it ought to be. And it also is worth remembering that the sovereign conveniently retains a monopoly on coercive power to enforce the law as he sees it. So this helps explain why the principles of Magna Carta have been really an unreliable guarantor of human rights. I mean, I've already mentioned the king's enclosure of Catholic monasteries in England and the enclosure movements of the 17th and 18th centuries. But in our own time, we've seen that constitutional democracy is not the fearless defender of due process, fairness, human rights, and commoning, especially since 9/11. I mean, the sovereigns of our time, the nation state in alliance with transnational corporations, have found plenty of ways to evade the supposed constraints of constitutional democracy and judicial review. We've seen how the self-declared national security state and the interests, at least of the US government, have trumped the rights of habeas corpus. And notwithstanding Magna Carta, the US military and CIA have inflicted torture on countless individuals and have had many thousands of military drone strikes that really amount to lawless extrajudicial assassinations. So one could go on, but the point is that the established institutions of constitutional government and democracy have often stood silently by, showing little interest in identifying and punishing flagrant abuses of Magna Carta principles. So there's kind of a dissonance going on in our contemporary political lives, because the sovereigns, the nation state and the market state, as I like to call it, they love to celebrate Magna Carta as if administering in a benign way over our modern order. And that's more or less what happened earlier this year in Westminster, England, when many political VIPs and top business executives from places like Goldman Sachs and Barrick Gold Corporation came out to celebrate the rule of law. And you could say that our fascination with Magna Carta over the centuries is in some ways aspirational, or if you wish to be more skeptical or even cynical, a useful cover story. We like to reassure ourselves or convince ourselves that power is indeed domesticated and is serving humanity in good faith. This may be true, it often is not as well. So, in truth, the neoliberal order as assisted by the state has proven to be as zealous and ruthless as King John was in enclosing the commons. States and the corporate sector now routinely collude in using law and legality to privatize our commonwealth. You can see this in the global finance sector, which has done so much to enclose our shared wealth. We see it in the Earth's atmosphere, which is used as a free waste dump by major industries, how biotech and pharmaceutical companies are allowed to convert life forms from genes and bacteria and even sheep into private commodities via patent law. Investors and sovereign investment funds are buying up huge swaths of land across Africa and Asia and Latin America in this massive global land grab now going on, which is dispossessing commoners by the millions and setting the stage for future famines. Companies are plundering oceans of fish, minerals. Latin America is now being victimized by massive neo-extractivist policies and projects. Everything from words and smells and colors can now be trademarked, and even 2-second snippets of music can be copyrighted. So in King John's time, enclosure was mostly about the forest. And today, it's really about really everything, including life itself. So to return to the question I posed earlier, who may use the king's forest? I think law today has become, in many instances, so captured or even corrupted by the contemporary sovereign, notwithstanding constitutions, elections, and courts, that there is little room for commoners to govern themselves or vindicate their rights in the face of the sovereign, because the sovereign market state insists upon controlling nearly everything by the logic of market exchange. So this leaves very little space legally, culturally, economically, for commoners to use their own commonwealth or to devise their own rules for managing things. Political and corporate elites and their affiliated retainers administer a system of formalized legality that presumes a moral and social legitimacy that is fast disappearing. And I think that this is because legality is so often used to trump what I call vernacular law, which are the norms and values of the street, or the moral and political authority of ordinary people. The law of the commons once declared by Magna Carta has become primarily an instrument of market state power and not an expression of the pre-political sovereignty of human beings. Because the market state has arrogated to itself the human rights that really precede the state. And these rights, of course, belong to commoners. In the United States, as you know, many corporations have been legally recognized as persons with all the civil rights and freedoms that real people are supposed to have. And yet, in a reversal, commoners and the earth itself are treated as brute, unfeeling commodities without dignity or rights of their own. So I think that these are some of the challenges we need to address in talking about Magna Carta these days. But you might say, why, despite these many shortcomings, do I celebrate the Magna Carta? I think it's because the Charter of the Forest, as incorporated into Magna Carta, has recognized the legitimacy of commoning. It's decriminalized it, and it made it legal for the first time in history. And this is important, I think, in itself. Finally, as a matter of law, people were granted a significant measure of formal legal freedom to govern themselves, to devise rules that seemed fair, legitimate, and effective for their circumstances. In other words, thanks to commoning and its formal recognition by the Charter of the Forest, the sovereign could not assert absolute legal authority. The people, the commoners, retained significant moral rights, human rights, and economic rights. And these timeless customary rights were guaranteed, quote, in a new type of formal written law, and the king recognized this fact. This was, of course, a significant advance in human governance. But here's the challenge I think that the Magna Carta leaves us with, how to reintegrate legality with legitimacy. How do we get the sovereigns of our time, the market state, to recognize the rights of commoners? I think the answer lies in reintegrating the idea of written law with vernacular law or commons-based law, the law of living communities of commoners. If we want to take the Magna Carta seriously, we need to reinvent some of the legal structures by which we try to fulfill the Magna Carta's principles in the modern age. I submit that what we really need to do is reinvent law for the commons. We need to draw upon the traditions of Magna Carta and state law, but deliberately carve out spaces for people to craft their own rules, rules that seem fair and appropriate to them, while being subject to some of the larger principles and human rights of the existing polity today. In other words, people must be allowed to engage in commoning. They must be able to play significant roles in managing their forests themselves, and in so doing, become stewards of those forests. They have to be able to draw upon their own insights and imagination and on their customary social practices. They have to be able to develop a sense of shared community and develop their own rituals and traditions in managing things and step up to some responsibility in that. One way of putting this I like to think of is that law has to honor people's affective labor, as geographer Neera Singh puts it, meaning the subjective feelings and emotions and pride and pleasure that comes with managing one's own commons. Now, this, of course, will require that we move away from the worldview of standard economics, which has the idea that we are all just isolated individuals who are disconnected from each other, without a history, without a culture, who are really just rational materialists. Of course, the commons proposes a different ideal of what human beings are. But the beauty of, I think, a law of the commons is that it goes beyond formal legalisms. Peter Linebaugh, the historian again, it stresses that the commons-based law, or the commoners, are grappling with their own evolving local circumstances, and that it's an imminent practical reality, not a fixed and eternal transcendent ideal, which is somehow off there. As Linebaugh writes, commoners think not of title deeds, but of human deeds. How will this land be tilled? Does it require manuring? What grows there? They begin to explore. You might call it a natural attitude. Commoning is embedded in a labor process. It inheres in the particular praxis of field, upland, forest, marsh, coast. Common rights are entered into by labor. So in other words, law is integrated with everyday life and practice quite intimately. It's not abstract and out there somewhere. So this is a very different ontological understanding of law itself. Law doesn't start with these abstractions and written documents. It starts with the gritty, particular realities as they're experienced by commoners, and it emerges from those experiences as people devise their own appropriate systems of self-governance. So in making the jump to formal written law, Magna Carta may have enshrined certain principles into the memory of civilization, which is quite no small achievement. I think that's quite significant. But that leap came at a cost, which was the gradual loss of the memory and practice of commoning, which I think is quite important to the legitimacy of law. So it's revealing that in the years after the Magna Carta, the king often had to reassure skeptical commoners and barons that he would in fact uphold his end of the bargain. So every number of years, he would grandly, with a grand flourish, reissue, reprint the Magna Carta to show that it was still the law of the land. But the real challenge in our time is to devise some new legal regimes that recognize and protect the commoning. Law must be crafted to help support these spaces. Let me close by saying that, you know, some people think that the commons is some arcane, archaic, medieval tradition. But in fact, it's really quite alive and around us right now. And to help sort of drive this point, Silke and I recently finished a book which will be coming out in October called Patterns of Commoning, which profiles several dozen contemporary successful commons in all parts of the world with many resource domains. And the idea was to show that today's indigenous agriculture systems, the high-tech fab labs, the alternative currencies around the world, the commons of open space farm equipment, open source farm equipment such as Fab Lab, a lot of collaborative mapping projects and much else are really our contemporary examples of commoning. In short, human beings are not just homo economicus, they are commoners. So this working on this sort of led me to the question, well, what would it look like if commoners could invent their own types of law consistent with state law to reliably protect their commons? What if there was a more rigorous law for the commons? So I realized, of course, that there was the history of Magna Carta, but could we commoners invent some new forms of commons-based law today? And those of you who are familiar with the digital world may be familiar with Creative Commons law, licenses or general public license as examples of this. Those are master strokes of legal ingenuity that I think we need to build upon and replicate in all sorts of different areas. And we can start to talk about some of those examples. Michelle will be talking in a minute about those. I'm pleased to say that you can look at some of these examples on a wiki that we published on the Commons Transition website, which Michelle Bowens and his colleague Stacco Troncoso maintain, which itemizes several dozen contemporary efforts of devising law for the commons. And I find it very inspirational that there's this template that we can build upon. So in closing, let me just say These principles can only be actualized through a political struggle. It's not just an imaginative legal effort. And we need to, the very idea that, I have no illusion that we can simply declare this. We have to struggle for it. But it, at a time when existing regimes of law and governance are in a shambles, starting to lose respect, not delivering people's needs, destroying the earth, I think commoning and laws commoning and law have a bright future because they're starting to point towards ways that are fair, open, and effective and can provide a measure of dignity, respect, and equality that we often find the market state regimes have trouble achieving. So with that, I'd like to introduce Michelle to elaborate on how some of this is occurring in the digital realm, the world of open source software, open design and manufacturing, hacker spaces, and so forth. This is the world of commons-based peer production where code itself and social practice are becoming a new type of law. So, Michelle, I'd like for you to sort of continue on in some of this arc. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Thank you, David. So good to have this tomorrow on YouTube so that we can re-listen carefully, because, I mean, it goes quite deeply into a notion I recently learned while writing our book, doing our book together, by a scholar of anthropology and law. His name is French. His name is Etienne Leroy. And he talks about juridicity. I translated it into Verrechtlichung. So where he's precisely explaining the process of the division of legality and legitimacy and how law, positive law, overruns and eclipses vernacular law and commoners' rights. So the very question is, first of all, it came to my mind if we shouldn't have called this event 800 years or 798 years of the Charter of the Forests. And then the very question that comes to my mind is, do those modern commoners whose area of main activity is not precisely the wood or the wasteland or the turf areas, but the fab labs, the hacker spaces, the urban commons spaces where we all share and co-produce and co-use, are they able to actually devise, show us the richness of society as a source of law and institutions that not only overcomes those pitfalls you've just described to us, but that also reconnects us to everyday life and social practices? Please, Michelle Bowen says, originally from Belgium, lives in Thailand, but that is an understatement. In fact, he's living all over the world, traveling endlessly, giving talks everywhere, and he's number, 85, 80, whatever number, he is on the enrich list of the most inspiring people for social change. Great to have you here, Michelle. That's your time.
Thank you. Of course, you know that Silke has a conflict of interest because she's part of the same group. So you don't have to believe her praise. Well, I guess before I go to today and the future, I'd like to give a little historical analogy, because I really believe that there are periods in history where things accelerate. I've just been reading a book which I keep raving about. It's called The First European Revolution. It's a really fantastic book that really shows how the 11th century saw an extraordinary acceleration and actually the actual creation of what we call feudalism. Until the 10th century, Europe was still living under the Roman system. The structures of antiquity were actually still there in the 10th century, masters, freemen, and slaves. By the 11th century, we see the start of the feudal system with masters and serfs, and the clergy on the side. And just a little anecdote. So this is a bit lesser known than the Magna Carta, but You know, the 11th century is both the birth of hierarchical law, the law of feudalism, but also of anti-hierarchical law, the law of the free cities and commoners' protection. So imagine, the Roman Empire went down, and in the 8th century, Charlemagne tries to recreate the Roman Empire and doesn't work. So he divides it up in three for his three sons, and that doesn't work either. So we have, in the 9th century, the period of castellization. And it's really a period of total warfare, of permanent warfare between barons. And the castles are not just a way to fight each other, but also a way to exploit the farmers. So they rape, they pillage, they steal church goods. And it's really a period of social breakdown. And it's that period that the monks of Cluny, followed by the people, the farmers, with the Virgin Mary up front, start confronting the feudals with their sins, basically. You know, in a period where everybody is a believer, this was a very powerful way of demonstrating. And so at that time, they sign in, hundreds of cities in France, what's called the Peace of God Charters, which establish that basically for the feudals, make love, not war. So, don't fight each other, marry each other. They install primogeniture, which is the inheritance for the firstborn son. So there's no more infighting in the family. And if you want to grow, well, you marry off your son to some other baron's daughter. So it kind of pacifies feudalism to a certain degree. And it also creates all these city charters, which allow then the cities to grow as well. So this was a period of acceleration of history, right? Of acceleration in which these new types of law were established in a very short period of time. I think we probably could say, although I'm not an historian, that the 16th century was also such a period, after the consolidation of the Italian city-states, the printing press, the Templars invent or reinvent double book entry accounting, the invention of purgatory so that Christians can lend money and not go to hell, Calvinism, if you get rich, it's because you actually are chosen. So all these ideological, pragmatic inventions become the basis of our capitalist society and also the creation of all these new private law tradition, right? And I really believe that we are living and going through the same type of period. We are living a period of civic constitutionalism or societal constitutionalism in which new type of productive communities, which are in an exodus, if you like, of the present dysfunctional system, start establishing new practices, new norms, and new legal forms. And David has done a really good job of outlining 10 of those fields that, in which we can see this. So let me just start by telling you that, so I see three new institutions emerging from what we call commons-based peer production. So what is peer production? It's the capacity that people now have to create value together, to self-organize, and to create shared resources, knowledge commons, design commons, software commons, and to create economies around it, to create livelihoods around these shared resources. You don't have to believe me, but there is an American report that says that the economy around shared knowledge resources is 16% of GDP and involves 70 million workers. Of course, these are not all open source communities. There is, for example, all the open geography, which has been given by the American state to the public. So this is not a resource that was constructed as an open source community, but which was subsequently donated and made into a commons, creates a huge economy around it, right? There's a shared resource, and it creates an economy around it. So three institutions are now being born. Just as, primogeniture was born in the 10th century, we have three institutions that generate their own legal practices and their own rules and norms. So I want to give you the first one is, I call them global open design communities. Global design communities are communities that are using networks to create a shared resource and that protect this resource with a license. right? So all these licenses, the general public license, the Creative Commons license, are examples of new law, of commons law. This is the social charter, like the city charters of the Middle Ages, which created the freedoms of the cities and created the community, right? With a wall around it and say, if you live here, the power of the Lord stops, right? The feudal Lord has to recognize our rights as citizens in the city. Today we have these licenses which say, if you follow these four rules, you're part of our community and this cannot be enclosed. The privatizers cannot come in our community and enclose our common resource. So I think this is a very powerful modern form of what we've seen with the Magna Carta. You know, think about the README files that are used in open hardware, or the facts, or the social charters like the Debian Constitution. These are all affirmative commons law that didn't exist 15 years ago and that's being reimagined to suit contemporary needs. The second institution that is born today, I call them entrepreneurial coalitions. And I don't know if Inspiral is here. Are you here, Alana? No? Yes? This is one of the great examples in the world. It's called Inspiral. It's an entrepreneurial coalition of 250 social entrepreneurs that also create Lumio, which is a global open source democratic decision-making system, and something called CoBudget, which is an open source software for reinvesting community resources in the further growth of the livelihood around these commons. One of the great innovations, remember the Templars with double book accounting? Well, today we have something called contributory accounting. It's a very important innovation. If you have an open source community, I give a very simple example. I work with Guerrilla Translation, which is a collective that translates commons text from English to Spanish and Spanish to English. You know, maybe 8, 9, 10 people do that. They're quite small. Well, by doing that, they create social capital, right? But then this guy comes along, David Bollier, and says, well, maybe you can translate my book. So this is the worm in the apple, right? Because what David is doing by paying these two people who are going to create this, translate his book, two people are going to extract value on the market based on the value that has been collectively created by 10 people over a long period of time, right? So there is an issue here of value extraction, of some people who are between the commons and the market taking more than the fair share of value. So contributory accounting is a way to deal with that. There are very complex systems around, like the ones by Sensorica, but the one in Guerrilla Translation is very simple to explain. Basically, all the pro bono translations are counted character by character and go in a second accounting. And the people who are engaged in the market give, I don't know if it's 10 or 15% of the income generated by the market to the second accounting system, which means that the people who have contributed get a fair reward for their work, right? I'm not sure how Inspiral does it. There's another entrepreneurial coalition that I like a lot. It's called Ethos Foundation. In the Ethos Foundation, what happens is that there is also an accounting for the market. So people who directly generate income for the community get the income from the market. And the people who generate value for the community, but not directly in the market, but actually strengthen the community, get virtual shares in a second equity. Right? And I'm not sure what they're going to do with it, but I think at some point they're going to sell this second equity form. And so the people, the contributors, will also get their fair shares. Now, I don't know if these will work in the long term, but just trying to show you the kind of innovation that is going on in these communities. They're not just applying accounting as we know it. They're reinventing accounting. They're bringing something new to the field. In terms of licenses, one interesting innovation I just heard about, just to give you an example. So one of the things that we work on in the P2P Foundation is called a copy fair license. And the reason we work on this is because it's the same issue, really. Commoners create value collectively, And then private players extract the value and do not necessarily reinvest in this collective value creation. And so we have a paradox. If you have a totally open license, I'm going to give it a provocative name, the more communistic your license, the more capitalistic your practice. Because it means, if you're totally open, that IBM can come in and start commercializing on a large scale and then effectively dominates that economy. And this is happening. This is the standard, actually, in the open source economy. So the copy fair would be a license that totally preserves the freedom to share the knowledge. That's totally preserved. So there is no restriction on sharing the knowledge, but it restricts the right to commercialize the commons to people who reciprocate to the community and the commons. Now, it doesn't exist yet, but there's a really innovative solution that was just found by the Fair Shares Association. And the Fair Shares Association is also interesting. It's a new way of considering equity that says there are four types of shares. For the founders, the entrepreneurs who have worked for years to make it possible to create this new thing, the funders, the workers, and the users. Because today, in the network economy, the users actively contribute to the value of any initiative. And the Fair Shares Association has found a creative way to use the Creative Commons licenses. On the outside, they use the non-commercial license. So everybody can use their commons. Everybody can use their knowledge, can build on the knowledge, can improve the knowledge, so it's not enclosed at all. But the commercialization, the commercial version, the commercial license is reserved for the members of the association. So again, you have to contribute to use that license. I'm just giving you as examples of showing you how, you know, these productive communities are actively innovating rules and norms and creating new legal realities. The third one, the third institution, is the Floss Foundation. So you probably noticed that most of these projects have foundations. The Wikimedia Foundation, the Linux Foundation, which is usually democratic institutions which maintain the infrastructure of cooperation. Okay, 4 minutes. Okay, let me just give you a very quick idea of what I'm excited about for the moment. One is the surge, S-U-R-G-E, of meta-economic networks. So we're all familiar that fab labs are exponentially growing, hacker spaces, co-working spaces, urban gardening, energy cooperative, especially here in Germany, but also in the Netherlands and Belgium and other countries. So we see that people are actively recreating new economies. There's no question about it. And there is a famous Dutch graphic. You see the growth of civic and cooperative initiatives until 2005, which is slowly growing, and then in 2005 is just exponential. So, you know, this is not an invention. This is happening everywhere. And so I'm very excited about the fact that these people are now starting to talk to each other, right? Simon Sarrazin, are you here? No? He didn't show. Oh, there you are. So that's one example. Encommun.org and Unison in Lille in northern France, where Simon and his friends are trying to create an economic network around commons institutions and commons business, commons-oriented businesses. So the idea is not just to have the food co-op and the credit union and the time bank, but to actively connect them to each other and to make them into, you know, a feedback, growing feedback system where they can strengthen each other. Maybe we can use our time bank dollars to get a loan for a community land trust with a credit union, right? This is the idea. Maybe we can use the stamps, I'll be very quick, that we get in the food co-op to do something with the time bank. So the idea of creating these flows of value, and of course to do that we need governance, property, lots of rules and norms need to be invented and tried out to make that work. Last thing, platform cooperatives. Today we have Uber, we have Airbnb. They serve, in my view, a useful function because they mutualize in their own way idle resources that we couldn't have access to before. But they do that by extracting value from the peer-to-peer exchanges. And, you know, having a Uber in your city is like having a supermarket, right? 30% of the value leaves your community and goes outside to the banks and to the shareholders in Silicon Valley. So I think one of the really important priorities is to create platform cooperatives so that, you know, the people who actively create the value also create their own platform so they can reinvest the value in the commons and in commons-oriented livelihoods. One more thing, Silke, I'm finished. I always play this trick, she knows me. We need voice, right? We need voice. So what we need to do today is also making sure that the policy world and the political world know what we're doing and know what our needs are. So I have suggested some years ago, and it's taking on a life now, assemblies and chambers of the commons, that all the commoners in a locality form an assembly where they can get to know each other, understand their concerns, and make proposals, if not demands, to the political world that this is what we need to live and grow. And Chamber of the Commons for all the entrepreneurial coalitions, but at the local level, who create ethical livelihoods around these common and shared resources, that they also create a voice, because the Chamber of Commons is not going to do it for you. Thank you.
Well, Michel, actually, I give you one more minute because I just learned something new. And this is like this. If you do like this in a space like this or in a conference, so you ask for clarification. Because you might have noticed that we are pretty international tonight, right? With people from New Zealand and France and the US and Great Britain, all over the world, actually. Because we do something we call deep dive on fair share for the commons. That's the issue we're working about in these days. And so I learned, and in this deep dive, I learned to do this. And I wonder how many of you got that idea of the README files as a new legal form for the commons? Did you raise your hand? Great, that's four people. That's not too bad. So might you re-explain me that? If I got it right, what David says, that idea of reinventing law for the commons at least has a double function, which is, first of all, rooting it in social practices, right? Reconnecting it to what we actually need. And secondly, as the Charter of the Forests did, put limitations to privatization. This happened 800 years ago for the first time. And so how do the README files, whatever that is, cope with both issues?
1, 2, 3, yes. Well, actually, you caught me on the one thing that I actually don't know. Because listen to this. I found out about the README files 2 days ago from somebody in Berlin who's called Lars Zimmermann. And
Is he here, Lars?
And he wrote an interesting article called Institutions of Open Source, and he mentioned the README file. I've seen it on GitHub and stuff. I never open it because I'm not a tech guy. But, you know, so the thing is that, maybe to partially answer your question, is that these rules and norms are contextual. As you said, they're contextual to particular projects who have to solve particular problems. And so we are in a state of emergence where these many communities are inventing, reinventing, finding solutions, experimenting solutions. But we don't stay there. If you look at Ostrom, you know, she will say on the one hand that every physical resource, every physical commons, every physical community is different. Not even, you know, a forest commons or an irrigation commons is the same. But she also found out that there were 8 principles.
Elinor Ostrom, who got the Nobel Prize for Economy in 2009 for her research on the commons, right?
Right. She also found that there were 8 common principles to the governance of these communities. So there's always diversity, but there's also commonality. Now, I think that one of the things that David has done is actually looking at commonality by already mapping out 10 different fields of emergence of this new commons law.
But yes, I'll answer that. I just wanted to elaborate on the README as well. I think the README files tend to be community annotations of what is intended by the code. You might say a legislative history. So I think to that extent, we can situate it within the law of the commons. But
yeah, and if one of the four who know about README files want to add to these explanations, so you are invited, because right now we opened the floor. It's your turn. Please share with us your ideas, your comments, your questions. And the idea is not just to have a question and answer section, right, but really share your ideas and to deeper explore this issue. There will be a mic. Yeah, with you? The mic is with you. So yeah, just raise your hand so that we can see who wants to speak. And just say two words of where you come from and who you are, please. Get up. Yeah, just for clarification, we anyway need a mic for the translation, right? So we should make sure it really works.
Hello. Hi, I'm Alana from New Zealand, from Inspiral. I had a question for David. When you were talking about the history of the Magna Carta, I was just thinking about how, like, right now in New Zealand, we have what's called the Waitangi Tribunal, which is where disputes between Maori indigenous people and the Crown over public assets, because our founding document as a country in New Zealand is agreement between a whole lot of Maori tribes and the Crown about shared ownership of the land, including resources, including the land and the foreshore and the radio frequencies and everything. I think, well, that's a really interesting question in terms of the commons as well. But it just occurred to me that it's the Waitangi Tribunal is versus the Crown. Like, is it now that the Crown is the way that we say the commons? And how did that happen? And why is there ever the people then in these legal systems represented in these disputes?
We can take more. Yeah. It's over there. Ah, yeah, here, go. Great.
Ich habe eine Frage auf Deutsch. Ich frage mich, ob die Magna Carta so ein großer Fortschritt ist. Natürlich, es waren die erste Niederschrift solcher Rechte, aber wie kamen die Rechte zustande? Ich mache es jetzt etwas grob. Ich nehme dir deinen Wald weg und gebe dir gewisse Rechte in diesem Wald zurück. Etwas, was 100 Jahre niemand vorher hätte kodifizieren müssen. Es ist dann auch kein Zufall, dass die Engländer nach Indien kamen und dachten, alles Allmendeland, alle Commons, müssten Eigentum des Königs sein, weil sie sich nichts anderes mehr vorstellen konnten.
Ferdinand Jentsch, Berlin. Ich frage mich und damit auch euch oder Sie, ist es nicht eine Ironie der Weltgeschichte, dass 800 Jahre nach der Magna Carta wir durch Verträge wie CETA, TTIP und so weiter am gleichen Stand stehen wie damals, nur dass jetzt nicht der König ist, sondern dass wir das privaten Großunternehmen bieten und denen jetzt eigentlich wegnehmen müssten? Also bräuchte man eine neue Magna Carta oder sollten wir diese Verträge möglicherweise auch gar nicht unterschreiben oder die sie unterschreiben wollen, daran hindern? Wenn wir wissen, dass 500 private Lobbyisten an diesen Gesprächen teilnehmen, von denen sind 90% Vertreter der Großindustrie.
Okay, we take one more and then we go back to the panel. There was see it very well. Who was first? Doesn't matter, right? We have another round anyway.
Thank you. My name is Marion Böker, and I'm in several NGOs, but as well social entrepreneur. I have a consultancy on human rights and gender issues. My question is at the beginning the same tendency to request the importance or the justice of the Magna Carta, because you missed out that the rights of the cities and Magna Carta was for citizens. Who was a citizen? It was a he, not a she. And I remember that the Jewish people were not allowed to live inside the wall, but outside the wall. And there were other minorities. So is the challenge of today, if we think for the future, not to create an inclusive law and inclusive sharing, which is not the normality. I mean, there is a hard fight about this. If we are honest and start from here, I agree that this is a very good way for the future. The second point is that are you talking about creating new law, because then you need punishments? Because I like the idea, there's no commercialization, but how? I mean, how can you stop anybody to do this? So there must be a punishment. And I'm working a lot with human rights treaty bodies and treaties. And is it a kind of vision to create a new human rights treaty about something like this? Because I think in Latin America and Africa, we could have a lot of partners. Here in Europe, I'm not so sure.
I think a lot of these questions center on the power of the state to be an adequate protector of commonwealth, especially the New Zealand question and the gentleman's question. The state has often claimed for itself the authority to be the guarantor and protector of this shared wealth, and we've seen in many, many instances it has simply betrayed that trust. It has not been a conscientious, rigorous trustee of the commonwealth. And I think what a lot of commoners are saying is we ought to have more direct control, or the state should not have such exclusive, sweeping, comprehensive authority to be the guardian of the public wealth. And in New Zealand, for example, the way that the state law has come into conflict with indigenous people's law, which is arguably more respectful and integrated with ecosystems as a living way of life, rather than something that's quite distant and oriented towards market extraction and, of course, harm and destruction of ecological things. So in some ways, we're talking about a struggle, which is the more legitimate body of authority to manage our shared wealth. And as for the question on human rights, similarly, we've reached limits on what the nation state and international treaty organizations can or will do to protect human rights. And I think some of this authority ought to devolve to smaller levels and be more socially integrated as a way with, I'm not saying either or, but new balances of ways of achieving human rights. I think within certain commoning communities, human rights may be more fulfilled by meeting people's everyday needs in a non-market way than the market state is doing, because we've seen so much deprivation or lack of concern for human rights through that system. So I think we need some innovation in types of law, and I don't simply mean a written document necessarily. It means a social practice that helps fulfill the law, and that's what I think the commons can contribute to this conversation.
No, I just want to confirm what one of the gentlemen said, is that a lot of these commons law only is generated when there are issues and when there are conflicts, right? As long as things go fairly well, nothing is written down. And if you look at the origin of the general public license, which is the basic constitution of open source communities, it was clearly created as a reaction to new enclosures, because science until that time was considered an open commons, and it only got more and more enclosed in the 70s. And I remember the story of Richard Stallman, that he used to repair his copy machine.
Richard Stallman, right? Who is
the founder of the Free Software Foundation. And of the general public license. It's only because one day somebody told him, oh no, there is a copyright or a patent on this printing machine, you can't touch it. That's when the need was felt for these copyright, these copyleft licenses, right, as a reaction to protect the commons. And I think it's entirely correct to say that before the Charter of the Commons, the commons was not as much under threat as when that had to be enforced. I wanted to give another example, if my brain cooperates, but I think it doesn't. Okay, so we'll wait for that.
As for this, you mentioned the sanction questions. I think many commons, Eleanor Ostrom, the political scientist who won the Nobel Prize in 2009 for her study of commons, one of her eight principles was that any successful, durable commons has a means for identifying free riders or people who harm the commonwealth or the community in ways of sanctioning them, usually in a graduated way. And the reason it's graduated is so that the relationships can be preserved. But the point is that the community is more organically connected to that whole enforcement of sanctions, and it's not a formal legalistic thing in which people who perhaps are not part of that community or don't know it well, in all sorts of arcane ways that we don't understand, will resolve justice. Whereas social communities, they have their own limitations in terms of what we would consider due process. On the other hand, they also are the basis for certain moral norms and authority, which I'm not sure I respect the authority of certain courts that expert lawyers and wealthy defendants can dominate. So I think, as for sanctions, I think there is room for these types of community-driven sanctions to help enforce better than the nation state or judicial systems can.
Well, I guess that there are people in the room who might contribute to that CETA TTIP question, right? So I want to invite you to help us out with this as well. Where's the mic? Is here David, and then you. Yeah, please.
Yes, I'm David Hammerstein of the Commons Network, which is a new European NGO. It's working on a lot of these issues. I'm based in Brussels. Over the last 5 or 10 years, we've seen some successes in overcoming the chasm, the tremendous rift between social practice and the legitimacy of laws. In one area has been in the area of culture, in immaterial knowledge, especially in the scientific area, the academic world. We've seen an academic spring rejecting the enclosure of publicly financed academic knowledge in enclosed journals, for example. We've seen the rejection of new licensing schemes to enclose text and data mining. Now this, I think, is going to become with an exception of copyright. We've seen areas of human rights to break enclosure, for example, for blind people, gaining an international treaty for an exception to copyright so blind people around the world can share their materials and text, which, by the way, is supported by the vast majority of European countries. But Germany and the Justice Ministry under SPD is blocking it because of the pressure of the publishers. So blind people all around the world, millions of them, cannot have access to Braille and digital works because of this fundamentalist position in the blocking majority in the European Union by the German Justice Ministry. But anyways, what I'm saying is that the immaterial world, or the non-rivalrous, the elements that are not rivalrous, I think there is space for moving that, but we're kind of in a contradiction. The people doing that on the ground, creating the commons on the ground, have kind of a suspicion, and it's kind of contradictory for them to take part in legal political battles on a higher level. So I think the idea of the Assembly of the Commons, the Chamber of the Commons, is very relevant. Now, my real question is on a totally different sphere, which is in the material sphere, which is in the sphere of nature. For example, right now, we're going into the COP on climate change, which has also a lot to do with immaterial commons, but a lot to do with the material commons. Nevertheless, nature and things, I have a problem explaining this when I talk about commoners. It seems they think, oh, well, you're very naive. You think that people getting together in communities are naturally going to defend nature and things. And if we read Bruno Latour, we see he has a whole new political structure of a parliament of microbes and things and scientific world with mediation of human beings to give a voice to the natural world. And I don't think it's naturally a given. And sometimes we see local communities who democratically decide to deplete nature, and it's happened over the last thousands of years. So I think obviously we need to be guided by principles, but also my question is, how could we also overcome the dualism between the natural world, the living world, things, microbes, et cetera, and kind of the cave we live in, the social cave we live in, that hasn't taken that account. So we have a real cultural enclosure as well in social that doesn't take into account the natural world. And I think we could see this in what's happening all around us. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Matthias Hayden. I think my question or comment kind of relates to this. It's also about the material world, because I'm not in the digital world so much. I really try to avoid it as much as I can, and I'm pretty much, besides being an architect and a planner, a city activist, and so my work is pretty much about the urban commons. And I just read a book by David Harvey, which is called Rebel City, and his chapter Urban Commons, where he's criticizing, but he's acknowledging Ostrom's work, but he's also criticizing it insofar that he's saying that her research is predominantly all the cases she makes, if I can believe him, what he's saying is all the cases she makes predominantly are small-scale cases. And the problem starts if you leave the neighborhood, and as soon as you hit the city space, like Berlin, a city of 3.5 million inhabitants, and then the region and the state and beyond, then you have a problem, and you will not get along with that kind of commoning which Ostrom describes. And so he's arguing that we need to reinvent not only or bring back the notion or the theory and the practices of the commoning, which is pretty much about a social practice on the ground in terms of getting rid of law, but bringing back, getting rid of the legal, but making more important the legitimate, right? I mean, I experienced this in 30 years in the squatter movement and neighborhoods movement. I mean, there you can get along without written words, right? If you meet everybody once in a while. But how do you come to agreements to rules and regulations, so to say, which are not based on law, but on legitimacy? And I think belief systems, value systems might be, to imagine another world is possible. I mean, we have that since 20 years. But I think it's more complicated. It also needs a systems analysis and basically an analysis and then very precise suggestions how to organize that systems change. And I bring you one example, and here I come to my question. Now we have one very prominent housing initiative in a former public housing estate. It's called Kotti & Co. And they're challenging the city government in terms of how they sold out half of the public housing stock in Berlin. And now big hedge funds are exploiting that situation to the worst. And they're basically challenging the city government for to re-communalize, to make it public again. And they're quite successful. We just have a process of a referendum, which is also being driven by that group. But they also are quite doubtful, even maybe fearful, what would happen if those formerly public housing estates would become public again, because they would not like to have it organized as it was organized by social democracy and all that long-going kind of management. So they are also thinking about how to reorganize a future public housing in the sense of the commoning. And then you're talking about hundreds of thousands of homes. So what are your ideas on that level, on that scale? My main question is a matter of scale.
And then we open the third and last round, so there will still be some time.
My name is Molina Gosch, I'm from Berlin. And I wanted to ask something about protecting the commons. I wanted to know if you have already heard about the term earth rights. And so, because now, like global change and everything that's going on, maybe it's time that we give the earth the right to live, and that we don't see it as a dead thing anymore, but as a living body that needs protection with earth rights.
Yeah, hope hopefully, my name is Thomas, WeShare Connector. I have maybe hopefully a short question to Michelle or everybody who can answer it, because you mentioned the platform cooperatives. Do you have some good example of European or German? I'm just trying to research, but I can't really find very much yet. And because that would be a practical, instead of Airbnb and Uber, or maybe like as the next step. But I don't, I don't know. Do you have some good examples beyond Fairmondo or some other platforms?
I need to admit that in this round, it's really hard for me to shut up and take my role as a moderator. David?
Well, I'd like to invite our esteemed moderator to chime in on some of these, because these are very very difficult questions, especially the ones on scale. And I think that there's two answers. The two environmental questions are related, which is, you know, people are talking about rights for the earth, and I think that's an important direction, albeit within the existing legal system. I think ultimately we need to get to a place of relationality, genuine relational, meaning our cultural relations, our social practices, and our identity are more connected with our physical places, our localities, our ecosystems, our cities. And it's about the human affect having a connection with the resource instead of the resource, you know, I being here, the resource there. And so the commons is essentially about reestablishing relationality and finding ways for in the appropriate scales. Now, I think the criticism that the Ostrom world of commons are only of a certain scale and they can't go larger, I think we haven't resolved that issue yet, because the internet has provided very interesting ways to federate small scales or even take them larger than we could imagine. I'm fascinated, for example, by this thing called the System for Rice Intensification, which is this global network of rice farmers who have traded agronomy practices for improving yields on rice, have improved yields 3, 4, 5 times normal rates. Now, admittedly, it's more of an information commons than a physical resource commons. Nonetheless, one can imagine within a certain bioregion federations of smaller scale commons that collaborate in assembly of commons types ways. This obviously has not, it's a future challenge in the sense we don't even have many the density of such commons. But you raise a very important question. David Harvey raises an important question about scale. But I think it's not just scale in the bottom to top hierarchical way, but the federating out. And this is a cultural thing, as opposed to a legal or a political thing or a institutional construction thing. So I think it's something that will emerge. That's my aspiration and hope. We don't know. So yes, for Earth rights, Bolivia and Ecuador have formally embarked upon that path. I'm not sure it's the final answer, but for now, it's certainly an advance of consciousness raising and maybe a way station to a better way of finding ways for law and social practice of commoning to respect ecosystems.
I just wanted to say that actually the role of the digital is about scaling, right? I mean, so last week I was in Paris. It's a castle 80 miles from Paris where there's a project called POC21, Proof of Concept 21. And it's 12 sustainable manufacturing projects. You know, it's all very physical. These are people making open source farm toolkits. As you may know, today if you buy a tractor in the US, you don't buy the tractor, you buy the software. You're forbidden to repair the tractor because that means interfering with the copyrighted software that runs the tractor. So farming communities are creating their own machines now in communities like FarmHack, Slow Tools Project, Atelier Paysan. I'm not sure they exist in Germany, but I believe they probably do. So their people are using the digital. It's not because they are immaterial, it's to scale. So if you have one sustainable manufacturing solution, the only way to scale it is to connect with similar communities across the world. So it's entirely physical, and the digital is the organizing tool. I recently read, not a book, but a review of the book. It's the title is, I'm not correct, but you can find it on Google. It's Poor to Poor, Peer to Peer. And it's a book about not digital nomads, but about a whole underground economy in Europe that almost nobody knows about. And this is that these are huge streams of trans-migrants that come 6 months to Europe to sell electronics to the poor communities in Europe. And they use the internet to negotiate prices, to tell people where they are, because they only appear like one day in a particular place, and they have the latest technology from China. And so all the poor migrants go there to that particular place, and then they have access at very cheap prices, or this very high tech. So this is entirely done informally at scale, at an enormous scale, using networks. I would also suggest things like, you know, these global open design communities, they scale. The Linux Foundation, the Wikimedia Foundation, they're examples of scaling, which we can learn from. So one of the ways in which they work is through protocols, right? Remember Occupy. Now, Occupy is maybe not a good example because it didn't last, but it was able to mobilize millions of people in a very short period of time, and it lasted several weeks. And the way they did was by using protocols, shared protocols, which if you follow certain rules, you can call yourself Occupy, right? Now, in open source communities, this is maintained through these foundations, which Occupy did not have. So I think, yes, I'm not saying I have the solutions, but I'm just saying that people are experimenting with solutions for scaling, and in such a way that the small group dynamics can be preserved, because I think this is the big worry. If we have to scale, that we, you know, go into hierarchy. Now we have here Christian Iaione, who's here, just who's been innovating in Italy with governance systems for the commons. There's the Bologna regulation for the care and regeneration of the urban commons, which is a whole new way of conceiving about the public service, not as a as an enabling mechanism for autonomous civic action, right? In Bologna, you can correct me if I'm wrong, citizens, collective, neighborhood collectives can propose ways to improve their neighborhoods. There's an evaluation mechanism, and then there's a negotiation between the city and the collectives about how the city can help the citizens realize these projects. So there's a lot of innovation in Italy around public commons partnerships and the commonification of public services, which I think we have a lot to learn from. So the problem is, I think that these things are happening and we don't know about it. I mean, that's for me the issue, is that we don't yet have a press and media that can scale up the knowledge of these experiences. And so I think we need to really look at that and learn from each other.
Last round. You start here, and where's the mic? Here we have the lady here in the second row to start with, and somebody here in the last row.
Hi, I'm Elise. I'm French, and so I'm pessimistic. It's in my DNA. I see a problem, which is that I fear that people have been dispossessed of this capability of creating. And I think the people who are now active in the open source community are a few, a really a few type of population. And I don't really see the scaling up happening, even if we have the medium to do it, because of the culture in the people. That's my question.
Ja, Ob Jelok, ich bin aus Berlin und ich befasse mich auch schon länger mit dieser Thematik aus meinem eigenen Interesse heraus. Ein kleiner Hinweis vielleicht vorab oder auch als Frage gedacht. Es war ja die Frage im Raume gewesen vorhin, wie sozusagen solche Rechte vertraglich gesichert werden können, was die Commons angeht. Und da gibt es ja jetzt einen aktuellen Fall, den kann der Herr aus den USA vielleicht besser beurteilen, wo eine Gemeinde in den USA gegen die Wasserprivatisierung ihres eigenen Brunnens klagt, und zwar aufgrund ihrer verfassungsrechtlich gesicherten Rechte. wenn ihm das nicht bekannt ist, das war eine Dokumentation im Fernsehen darüber. Und da war sozusagen Nestle, glaube ich, oder jedenfalls ein Großkonzern, der wollte dieses Wasser für seine Zwecke benutzen, also privatisieren, was eigentlich ein öffentliches Gut ist und auch rechtlich dieser Gemeinde von der Verfassung zugesichert war. Es war ein langer Prozess im Gange deshalb und jetzt ist es eben irgendwann hochgekocht und in den USA vor dem Verfassungsgericht gelandet. Das ist nur eine Schiene, wo man mal zeigen kann, wie sich auch solches Recht vielleicht in einer anderen Form sichern lässt. Ein anderer Hinweis, was diese Ausrichtung allein auf die Rechte angeht. Ich denke, wenn man mehr für die Commons tun will in der Welt, auch mit diesen Skalierungsproblemen, dann sollte man einmal ökonomisch über Rahmenbedingungen nachdenken, die sozusagen sowas sichern und auf der anderen Seite auch über rechtliche Rahmensetzungen weltweit. Also es gibt ja den sogenannten Weltmarkt mit seinen Welthandelsstandards und genauso muss man diese Dinge eben auch weltweit rechtlich dann absichern, sei es über die UNO oder andere Organisationen, die dort also rechtssetzend sind. Beispiel, wie es auch einen Weltsicherheitsrat gibt, so gibt es eben auch ein Weltgericht und so weiter. Und dieses muss natürlich dann auch, darf natürlich nicht missbrauchbar sein, denn für bestimmte Machteliten, sondern das muss dann auch durchaus demokratisch denn gewählt werden und auch kontrolliert werden. Gut, also als Anregung.
So we take Heiner and then you, the lady, as the last one for tonight, okay?
Banking. I'm in the Global Commons Alliance in ECOSOC and I'm very enthused about the discussions because we are think we are doing here an interesting step. Talking about scale. And in the early days of discussion of scale, it was said scale is more than size. It has proportions and consequences. And when discussing with Eleanor maybe 15 years ago, she was aware of that. She was looking into utilities of very large towns like LA. She was really looking what we call 25 years ago global, to really bridge what UNESCO calls tangible and intangible knowledge. So when we go to the scales, proportions, consequences, then we should be very much aware that these cultural commons are holding us and binding us together. So I think when we follow up on that track, like we try now with the SDG discussions in New York, to really see what our inner commons, and it's not only what we can eat.
Hi. My name's Mary Meller from Great Britain, and my area of interest is in the recognition and transfer of value. And I've been particularly interested in the socialization of money and the democratization of money. And it seems to me that the secret capitalism had and the way it got going was it issued credit to itself ahead of its production. And it seems to me that if you want to grow in scale, what you're going to have to do is invent a means of value or capture ordinary public value, that is the public currency, into your social networks so that you create credit ahead of the activity. Because that's the way capitalism grew. And I think the social sector's got to grow in the same way.
Well, the last comment, we could speak all evening, and I think it's a fascinating, provocative question.
You can actually do. There will be an opportunity to do so. Yeah, no problem.
I'll just bracket and let Michelle, who's more knowledgeable about alternative currency, speak to that. But I agree with that basic sentiment, that we need alternative units, currencies of value for commons to begin to be able to not simply be hostage to the prevailing financial system and money systems. I will leave that. Should I just speak to the other questions then? I agree that we have, you know, culture is a very difficult thing to change, but I think the history of open source software or the idea of open source as a cultural meme has been phenomenally powerful, going into all sorts of different realms of life beyond software or even the digital realm. And I think because it appeals to a fundamental notion of participation and fairness and access. So, you know, I think this is a long-term struggle, you know, but I think that the precedents of the open source way of doing things are itself a kind of a cultural lever or fulcrum that we can build on. But you're right, there's a lot of reactionary or inert cultural areas that are just very difficult to penetrate. I think it is a long-term struggle. As for the gentleman's question about the community owning the water, I don't know the specific case you're referring to, but traditionally the state has sovereign control over these resources, and historically the state often just colludes with the market to give it away. And for the community to have the legal entitlement to protect that, especially against the federal or interstate commerce, federal government or interstate commerce, is exceedingly rare and certainly not a constitutional right. The only thing I can think of is the public trust doctrine, which is a very ancient doctrine which says the state cannot take away or give away that which belongs to the public. It has to protect it. So that may be one source for protecting this water, but in general, communities don't have many legal entitlements to protect their water or other resources, unfortunately.
Yeah, I want to address the French pessimism, maybe. I just saw a video yesterday with Benoît Poulvord, who is a Belgian cineast, and he was saying when he makes a movie in France and there's a car in the way, you know, there's a whole chain of command shouting, "Why is there a car in the way? Why is there a car in the way?" And it goes down to the, you know, the last person, and then nothing happens. Where in Belgium they just move the car. So that's, I think, particular, you know, to the Jacobin tradition, is this very strong idea in France that things have to come from the state and from above, and that disempowers people. But it's also because it's exactly why you have revolutions in France. And I just recall that the day before May 68, what was his name, Bertrand Delpech or something, he wrote, "France is bored." And the next day, Paris was on fire. But anyway, so I just want to say that, you know, it's the engagement, I think, from minorities which creates a change first. And the thing is, when you create a commons, this is my experience, you love what you do, and you cannot help but become optimistic because you love what you do. And hopefully, and that's also, of course, the hope, is that it's like a contagion, that when people see that you're changing and that, you know, you're creating a new life and new livelihoods, that they will become inspired somehow to do the same. And I don't think we need the whole population to change. There's various calculations I've seen. For example, in the consumption world, 2% of the consumers can change a whole industry. There are several studies showing that. And you think about the Renaissance, you know, a few thousand people changed the whole character of Europe. So I don't think we should be pessimistic. I think we have a duty to be optimistic, not because we're sure we'll win, but because it's the only way to mobilize our energy.
We should certainly not be optimistic, but doing everything to really connect the dots. I have the feeling that I find this pretty often, that people say, "I come more from the natural commons or the urban commons or whatever, and I'm not really knowledgeable about the digital and the cultural commons, etc." And we just shared an example this morning in the train when coming here, that just imagine you want to do something like the degrowth movement. It's all about reuse and co-using and stuff, and doing modular things. So in order to make them really sustaining for years and using them for years instead of planned obsolescence thing, etc. Just imagine they now use copyright law or the so-called IP, intellectual property law, to forbid this, to forbid reuse and repair. And that's what's coming. So just you make the connection of how we need to deal with the knowledge commons if we want to federate all the communists all over in the world, which are pretty many. And I'm really happy to have here in the room communists from all over the world. One quick last comment on that idea of public and commons, and also the idea of scaling. It seems to me that sometimes the doubt that we cannot scale is based on a wrong notion of the commons, or on a limited notion on the commons, of the commons, so to say. When I started doing my first book on the issue, it was in Spanish, and was then translated into German, which was called Who Owns the World? It was very much based on that idea that there's a common pool resource, you know, and we need to manage it collectively. So very much Ostrom style. And then we moved on doing this anthology, and we learned when closing the book, you want to do a new one because you didn't get it right. Yeah, that's what happened. And so we did a new one where we really conceived the commons as a whole set of institutions. That it's not only about a limited amount of resources. Actually, there's no thing in the world you cannot convert into a commons. So the commons don't fall from the sky, nor are they limited to a specific set of resources. We make them, and we can make everything a commons. Okay, so we went on with that. And then the question is, how do you do that? So it's like the key notion of the next book. When we closed this one, which is called Commons, we realized that, in fact, at the very heart of the issue is this, commoning. So we needed to do a book on commoning. While we were working on the book on commoning, which is not yet out, we already realized that's not deep enough. We need to go a level deeper. No, that's written it.
It's not as if these are wrong. It's like new questions and insights emerge.
Yeah, and that, so we went to the ontological level and the epistemological level. What I want to point to here, and just relate back to the title of our wonderful evening tonight, is why do we still celebrate Magna Carta, Klaus? You asked that question, right? Because at least it still had the notion of the commons clearly enshrined. If you look at today's laws, there's something called like commonwealth. There's not even an idea, a concept, and the notion of the commons anymore in modern law. So that's the challenge. Thank you so much. Have fun chatting outdoor. Thank you so much for the translate. This must have been a tremendous challenge, and extra applause for you. And to the technicians and the Bell Foundation, thanks a lot.